quality as Jesus.
Amen.
And look at this. This was, not only did he send the helper, but he sent the helper to walk alongside of them like Jesus did. But that same helper, not only does he walk alongside, but he lives inside. Amen. When he said, greater works than this you shall do. And you think about the words of Christ here. I mean, he multiplied the bread and the fish. He rose from the dead. He healed people. And you're thinking, well, we don't see that today. And the Lord said, because you're only looking at the external things. The same people that rose died. The same people that were fed, if they didn't have a way to feed themselves the next day, went hungry. Those works were great. They were awesome. But the works he was talking about was leading people into eternal life.
Yeah.
That's greater than the temporary things that those people had experienced.
Yeah.
Not because God could believe that Jesus could lead them into eternal life, but their hearts weren't even there.
Right.
They followed after him for what they could receive from him.
Yeah.
Not what he can give into them. Many of them only followed for the temporary things. Right? But he's implanted in you his spirit so that you can draw men to him so that they can receive eternal life.
Yeah.
Eternal completeness. Amen. A water that will, that if they drink, they will never thirst again.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
That's the greater works that we are to do.
Yes.
And that's because of the indwelling of his spirit. That's because of his Holy Spirit living in us, leading us, speaking to us. And it still requires you to submit and to surrender unto him.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. We talked about it again this morning. We use David as a great example. Many times when we're looking at one another, we judge from our exterior what we see. We see Pastor Pat saying he's tall, he's strong. You know, we make judgments based on what he looks like. And many times people will look and they'll say, oh, because he looks this way, he can't be that. Right? Or they'll look at her and say, because she's this way, she must be that, because she looks a certain way.
Right.
Many of us can put on our facades. We can put on our makeup in the right suit, and we can even speak the right word, but it really doesn't mean that what I'm saying is what's in me.
Right.
Amen?
Yeah.
And so a lot of times people judge us by our exterior, but again, the Lord says to know them by their spirit, know the tree by its fruit.
Yeah.
And so we use David as an example this morning, which I thought was an awesome example that the Lord had given us. David not being considered anything among his brothers and among his father. He was considered the lowest of the family, but not just because he was young, but because he wasn't as strong, and he liked a strong harp and sing. And so he got assigned to the, he was short, and he was shorter than everyone else, because Saul was tall, right? Their first king was really tall, and he was handsome, and he was taller than most of the people in the nation. And so, and that looked like what all the other pagan kings had. And so when Samuel went and he looked and he saw the first son, Eliab, and he's thinking, oh my goodness, look, he's tall too, he's virile, he's a man's man. And he goes, surely this must be the man that God has chosen as the next king. And God said, oh no, you're looking at the wrong thing.
Right.
You're looking at the exterior.
Right.
The man that I've chosen, I know his interior. I know what's in his heart. And he went through every one of the sons.
Yeah.
And everyone got rejected. And he says, don't you have any more sons? Because he knew the Lord sent him to this house. I can't remember the dad's name.
Jesse.
Thank you. Jesse's house. He couldn't, don't you have any more sons? And he goes, well, I have one more. And it was kind of like, are you sure? I have one more. And, you know, just send the sheep and shrug us apart and sing songs. And, you know, he's a lover, not a fighter kind of thing, right? Because he
going to go to war. So they don't think much of him because they don't see. This is a person who only speaks in tongues at home. So they don't get to see all the things that he has accomplished in Christ. This is a person who intercedes at home and then I try to show their power and authority everybody else. In church or in the street, right? So they don't see it with their natural eye. And so when God, when he sends for David and it comes, God says, that's him. But you know what I think is awesome? And now I don't think I'll ever forget this. David wasn't considered much among his family. And any of us who have siblings or a parent who just kind of look at you like, huh? You know, just one little look can make you feel like nothing for a long time.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
But you don't really get that from him. Why? Because he allowed himself to stay within God's spirit. He allowed himself to stay before the Lord. He was strong in his heart for the Lord.
Yeah.
He was tending the sheep for the Lord. What he chose to do, not that he was perfect. This is not the story of a perfect man, but this is the story of a man of flesh allowing God to lead you.
Yeah.
Amen. Because I want you to hear that. I don't want you to think that he was perfect. Because if you think he's perfect, then you can obtain what he obtained.
Right.
And that's not true.
Right.
This is a man who submitted and surrendered to the perfect will of God. Amen. Even in his mistakes, even when he was self-righteous, when he was confronted, he immediately repented.
Yeah.
He immediately knew that he had fallen from God's grace and he needed to get back where he was.
Yeah.
But he was able to move that way because he allowed God to perceive him. He didn't have to speak for himself. He didn't have to boast about how many animals he had to kill to protect the sheep. He didn't have to boast about how he entered into the presence of the Lord through song. He didn't have to boast because God spoke for him.
Yeah.
As ministers, you don't need to go out. I don't go out and say, I am Pastor Nicole, Church of Christ in the New Church. I'm Nicole. Even here, I'm Nicole. The title means nothing. Who am I representing? And is he proceeding out of me? That's what's the most important thing.
Amen.
As a minister, as a child of God, the Lord, the Spirit of God, should proceed from you.
Yes.
And in that, who cares what your title is?
Amen.
Who cares what job you have in the ministry? No one cares. It's not important. What's important is God proceeding from you? Does he speak through you?
Yes.
Is he using you? Amen. Are you surrendering and submitting unto him? Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And also in Galatians, it talks about Galatians 5 and 16, when he talks about walking by the Spirit, he says in verse 17, For the flesh desires what is contrary to the Spirit.
Yes.
And the Spirit what is contrary to the flesh. See, that's the battle.
Mm-hmm.
That's the battle. They are in conflict with each other so that you are not to do whatever you want. But if you are led by the Spirit, you are not under the law. We know what the acts of the flesh are. They're in conflict with one another.
Yes.
And so sometimes when you feel that, I think we talk about in prayer, when you feel that conflict, the best way to dissolve the conflict is through fasting and prayer.
Yeah.
Right? Jesus said some things just don't change but by fasting and praying. And because sometimes our flesh is just so ornery, and it's so judgy, and it's so self-righteous,
and
it's boastful, it's loud, it's unseemly. I mean, it's just the truth. How many of us know without the Holy Spirit, we will behave unseemly every day?
Amen.
And some of us, you know, we have to say we have that quiet allegiance. I haven't said that about myself. I have that quiet allegiance. But even when I have the quiet allegiance, without the Holy Spirit, I still behave unseemly.
Yeah.
I still behave contrary to who God called me.
Yeah.
Opposite of what God created me.
Yes.
It didn't matter if I was dignified. I've seen some really large dignified people.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
So you can put on man's standards all you want. You're still sane.
Yeah.
And you're still dirty.
Right.
But when you put on a robe of righteousness and you clothe yourself and you bathe yourself in
the perfume of His Spirit draws people to you so that you can speak into their lives and that you can minister into their lives and open up a way for them to receive Christ for themselves.
Yeah. Amen? Yeah.
When you allow Him to just permeate you with His anointing, you don't have to run after everybody. They're going to come to you.
That's right.
Can I get a witness?
Amen.
They come to you.
Yeah.
Amen? And that's awesome. Because you know, again, it's not your work.
Right.
It's not your work. Oh, I got to get the streets in. I got to witness. If I don't, them people down there are on God, they're just going to be saved. They're not going to be saved. They're going to go to hell. It's not you. You don't have any beautiful words. You don't have the best way. It's not your words, your dictionary. Dictionary in one hand, the source in the other. It's not going to draw them. It has to be by the Spirit.
Yeah.
Amen?
Yeah.
It has to be by the Spirit of God. And you don't have to turn here, but in Psalms 8:4, David says, "What is man that you are mindful of me? And what is human beings that you care for them?"
Yes.
He cares for us. The Holy Spirit, He loves us. Have you ever heard that? You hear God loves us. God is love. And Jesus loves you so much. And He died upon the cross. But how many times have we heard how much the Holy Spirit loves us? He cares for us. When we're in sin, He doesn't just abandon us and say, "Oops, you messed up, I'm out." But He lovingly draws us back. He lovingly corrects us. He speaks to us. He chastises us. The Lord chastens those whom He loves, right? He loves us. What is man that He is so mindful of us that even though He knew that today at 3:00 I was going to mess up, He still said, "That's my word." When even when Samuel said that David was king, He knew a few years later David was going to sleep with Bathsheba and kill Uriah. He still said, "That's a man after my own heart."
Right.
That's how much He loves us. He knows our beginning and our end. So nothing you've done has surprised Him
right.
or shocked Him.
Right.
He's not shocked. There is no shock factor in God.
Amen.
Okay?
Amen.
But because He loves you, even though He knows what you've done and what you're going to do, He still calls you home.
Yeah.
If you can't serve God like that, something is dead inside.
Right.
It's probably because you don't have the Holy Spirit.
Yeah.
Right? Because without Him, you were dead inside.
Right.
Right.
But He brings us life. He quickens us to life. Amen?
Yeah. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The work of the Holy Spirit is to save the children of God. I remember reading a book years ago, and this minister was saying, "How do you know that she's saved?" And the person was like, "Well, because she received God as the Lord and Savior, but she don't know if she was chosen." And I think it was Macy Calvin. And it disturbed me, and I was like, "I don't understand it." And the Lord says, "Well, you won't know you're chosen until you're chosen." Meaning, if you're saved, you're chosen.
Yeah.
Period. If you receive Him as your Lord and Savior, you're chosen.
Right.
If you don't, and you never do, you weren't chosen. But was it based on His choosing or yours? Say that again. Because He knows you're beginning and you're in.
Yeah.
He knew you weren't going to ever choose Him. Is that cheating?
Nah.
He gave everybody equal opportunity.
That's right.
That's the difference. Even though He knows in advance what your choice is going to be,
yeah.
He didn't like say, "Well, don't witness to her. She's never going to come to me."
Right.
He didn't say, "Don't minister, don't pray." He never said that. There's never a point in the Bible where He says, "Don't witness to this person or these type of people because they're never going to come to me." Every one of us has equal opportunity to come to Him.
Yes.
But because of our choices is why we weren't chosen or why we weren't chosen.
Right.
Holy Spirit came to each and every one of us. The Holy Spirit spoke to each and every one of us.
Yeah.
Those who rejected and those who received. It was up to us to choose.
Right.
And when you receive Him, don't stop there. Because He has treasures hidden within Him that He's placed in you. That He just, He's excited for you to unlock them. When you search the scriptures, he's excited for you to unlock those treasures within you. Don't stop it just on saying I'm good. You miss so much.
Yeah,
you say when you get to heaven, but goodness. Then you get up there, you get to hear Pastor Maria's story, you get to hear Tiffany's story, like, I didn't get to do that. I missed out on that. Well, you just sat on a pew and prayed. You missed out on so much because you thought I'm good.
Right.
But the Holy Spirit, he wants to unlock the treasures of God. The scripture says he searches the deep things of God so that we can know the deep things of God. Amen?
Yeah.
That's the saying, who taught you Hebrew?
What's that?
Who taught you Hebrew?
Who taught it to me?
Mm-hmm.
God.
God.
Yeah.
Amen. Who brought you to Christ? Who led you to Christ? God. God. Who led you to Christ?
God.
Who causes you to want to do the work that you do around here?
Amen.
God. Amen. The things that we do is because the Lord drew us. Amen. I was reading earlier where Paul was talking about when the Lord came to him on the road of Damascus. He didn't immediately get up and run to the apostles, run to Jerusalem. He didn't immediately run and say, teach me, right? He actually took some time and asked the Lord to teach him. He allowed the Lord to speak to him. Before he even met with any of the apostles known, any of those known to help establish churches, it was just him and the Lord for a while. I think 3 to 7 years, something like that. He spent time with the Lord. So I'm saying that to say this. We come to church Sundays and Wednesdays, and that's great, but your true time is you and the Lord.
Right.
Your true time to really, really get the meat of what he has for you, the true direction, it's not going to be here. We're here just for a couple of hours. And typically, our messages are for the general population, and not necessarily strictly just, I'm just me. Just me. Forget them. It's not that. You get that one-on-one in your personal time. You get that one-on-one after you've gone home and you sat before the Lord and you allow him to minister to you, you allow him to speak to you. You hear him, you talk a little, you talk a little. You laugh a little, you laugh a little. You cry a little, you cry a little. You get to know him. Amen?
Yeah.
If you really truly want to be effective in ministry, you have to daily, moment by moment, and situation by situation, submit unto the Spirit. Amen?
Yeah.
And then last thing. When Jesus was here, I was in John.
Yeah.